Welcome to this service for churches in the York Circuit. As usual, you're invited to sing along with the hymns if you wish, and also to join in the highlighted sections of the prayers and the readings. We begin with a verse from the Psalms. This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it.
Come on and celebrate, His gift of love we will celebrate, the Son of God who loved us and gave us life. We'll shout your praise, O King, you give us joy nothing else can bring. We'll give to you our offering and celebration praise. Come on and celebrate, celebrate, celebrate and sing. Celebrate and sing to the King. Come on and celebrate, celebrate, celebrate and sing. Celebrate and sing. Celebrate His gift of love, we will celebrate the Son of God who loved us and gave us life. We'll shout your praise, O King, you give us joy nothing else can bring. We'll give to you our offering and celebration praise.
Our opening prayers, you're invited to join in the words in yellow. O Lord, our Lord, your greatness is seen in all the world. Your glory fills the heavens, yet you welcome the praise of your children. When we consider the vastness of the universe, we are amazed that you should care for us, and that you receive our worship and prayers. May your greatness be proclaimed in our worship and your name honoured in our lives, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The earth is the Lord's and everything in it, the world and all who live here. Who may go up the hill of the Lord? Who may enter his holy temple? Those who have clean hands and pure hearts, who do not worship idols or swear by what is false. We say together, creating and redeeming Lord, we confess that we have abused your creation with our hands, that we have set our hearts on material things rather than on your kingdom, that we have not been true to what you have revealed of yourself in your word and in your Son. For his sake, forgive us, and recreate us by the power of your Holy Spirit, that we may worship and serve you with grateful hearts. Amen. He who sits on the throne says, I am making all things new. These words are trustworthy and true. Thanks be to God. Amen. Loving Father, in whom we live and move and have our being, grant us to live in fellowship with you, at peace with one another, and in harmony with your creation, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Gospel reading for today is in dramatised form, and you are invited to join in the part of the people.
The next day, some boats from Tiberias came near the place where they had eaten the bread after the Lord had given thanks. So when the crowd saw that neither Jesus nor his disciples were there, they themselves got into the boats and went to Capernaum looking for Jesus. The people found Jesus on the other side of the lake.
Rabbi, when did you come here?
Very truly I tell you, you are looking for me not because you saw signs, but because you ate your fill of the loaves. Do not work for the food that perishes, but for the food that endures for eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. For it is on him that God the Father has set his seal.
What must we do to perform the works of God?
This is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he has sent.
What sign are you going to give us then, so that we may see it and believe you? What work are you performing? Our ancestors ate the manna in the wilderness. As it is written, he gave them bread from heaven to eat.
Truly I tell you, it was not Moses who gave you the bread from heaven, but it is my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is that which comes down from heaven and gives life to the world.
Sir, give us this bread always.
I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. A verse from Deuteronomy and chapter 8. God made you go hungry, and then he gave you manna to eat, food that you and your ancestors had never eaten before. He did this to teach you that you must not depend on bread alone to sustain you, but on everything that the Lord says.
Be added unto you.
you went to a service last week, you might have heard the feeding of the 5,000 being read. This week and for the next 3 weeks, the Gospel readings continue with the dialogue between Jesus and the crowd following the feeding of the 5,000. John often uses these dialogues between Jesus and individuals or groups to explore a topic, using a technique reminiscent of the Greek philosophers, but it might also reflect the methods of the Jewish rabbis. As with Nicodemus and the woman at the well earlier, the dialogue is based on a misunderstanding by the individual or crowd. Indeed, they might come across as rather stupid, so apologies for asking you to play the stooge in the reading. But we might argue that the failure to grasp the message is deliberately exaggerated to enable Jesus to make the point. In all three of these examples, the misunderstanding is over something that could have a material or a spiritual meaning. With Nicodemus, it is being born again. With the woman at the well, it's living water. And in the feeding of the 5,000, it is bread. And the point in each case is to look for the spiritual rather than the material meaning. And this is very much the thrust of John's Gospel, sometimes referred to as the spiritual gospel. Not that the others aren't spiritual, but the symbolic rather than the face value meaning always seems to dominate in John. So Jesus berates the crowd for following him because they're hoping for a free lunch rather than because they see him as the bread of life. Not that this is only in John's gospel. In Mark, for instance, it is the disciples rather than the crowd who get told off for not understanding the feeding miracle. And the point about focusing on the spiritual rather than the material is found throughout the Gospels in passages like "Seek first the kingdom of God," and that rather harsh advice that it's better to lose a hand than to be spiritually disabled. So there's no point that this emphasis on the spiritual life was a key theme of Jesus. But it is true, perhaps in our own prayers, that our agenda tends to be dominated by material rather than spiritual concerns. But as I often say, there is in many scenarios, which we think of as being either or, a question of balance. And we often have to say that it's not a question of either or, but of both and. Jesus didn't heal blind people just to make a spiritual point about blindness. He did physically feed the crowd, and this was at least as much about responding to their physical needs as making a spiritual point. So I want to say two things about this physical, spiritual debate. Firstly, I want to say Jesus is concerned with both. This passage and others like it correct our human tendency to focus on the material world. But that doesn't mean the material is irrelevant. That is the emphasis of some religions and sects, but not of the Christian faith. James tells us that if someone is hungry, it's no good sending them away with a blessing. It's as if he is saying that there is a danger of the spiritual pendulum swinging too far in one direction. The church has often struggled with this balance and even been divided by it. So the debate can be about whether our mission is to feed the hungry or to spread the good news. And the answer is clearly both and, rather than either or. We can find passages in the Bible designed to counter either extreme, which is why both sides can feel that they have scripture on their side. Secondly, in case it isn't obvious, this compartmentalisation of our mission is a false distinction anyway. We can't separate meeting people's physical and spiritual needs. And this, for me, is the most significant message of the feeding of the 5,000. It's not just that Jesus fed the people physically and spiritually, as if we can separate him first teaching them and then feeding them. It's that he fed them spiritually by feeding them physically. And this is the mystery that we preserve in our sacrament of Holy Communion, but also in less formal ways. Unfortunately for me, communion has become stylized over the years, so a scrap of bread and a sip of wine is hardly going to keep us going until lunchtime, so we often have refreshments afterwards instead. For me, the ideal would be more like a love feast, where the physical and the spiritual feedings are more integrated, but you may disagree. We get some ideas in the New Testament why this separation of the two feedings occurred, including here this dialogue in John's Gospel, but also Paul's passage about the love feast being abused. We're always in danger of the material dominating. But the answer to abuse, we often say, is not disuse, but right use. So the challenge is to see the spiritual in the material, rather than to reject the material world. The verse I read from Deuteronomy refers to the people of Israel being fed by God in the desert. And that feeding was very important in how the people of Jesus' time understood the feeding of the 5,000. But note again how the physical feeding and spiritual nurture go together. God made you go hungry, and then he gave you manna to eat. He did this to teach you that you must not depend on bread alone to sustain you. It's not then that God feeds them and teaches them as two separate acts. The people grow spiritually through the experience of being fed with the manna. And it seems to me that this is a good model of how God works in our lives too. Thanks be to him.
Victims. Let us pray. A prayer for today. Lord and giver of life, you alone nourish and sustain your people through Christ, the bread of life. Feed our hunger and quench our thirst, that we may no longer work for what fails to satisfy, but do what you require in obedience and faith, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our prayers for others. And so we pray for people who are deprived of bread for their bodies, through war, through poverty, because their harvest has failed, or because of our unfairness in sharing the good things of life. We pray too for the millions of people who do not have access to the fresh, clean water that we take for granted, and have to carry water for miles, and who are ill because the water they drink is not clean. We pray for people deprived of food for their minds. Children who have no chance of going to school because there are no schools, or because they're too poor to go. Children even in our own country who have no experience of the countryside or of art, books and music. People whose lives are so hard that they have no time or money for recreation. And we pray for people deprived of food for their souls, those who don't know the good news about Jesus, those whose picture of God is not of a loving Father, people who live in countries where churches are banned or Bibles not available. Forgive us, Lord, for taking these things for granted. Heavenly Father, you have given us life and continue to feed us in body, mind and spirit. Help us to make good use of the gifts you have given us and to share them with others, that we may grow strong together. We ask our prayers through the bread of life, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And we say together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
My people cry, all who dwell. hearts of stone. Give them hearts for love alone. I will speak my word to them. Whom shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard you calling in the night. I will.
So may the love of God transform us, that we may bring forth the fruit of his kingdom. And may the blessing of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon us, upon those dear to us, upon his church and his world, this day and always. Amen.